the Lamb. No one can hinder thee. Hosanna to King David's son. No one can hinder thee. He rides upon a donkey small. No one can hinder thee. The King of peace, the Lord of all. No one can hinder thee. Ride on, King Jesus. No one can hinder thee. Ride on, King Jesus. Ride on. No one can hinder thee. The children sing and they dance and shout. No one can hinder thee. They won't praise the rock. All his pardoning grace, no one can hinder thee. Join the throng, your voices raise, no one can hinder thee. The King of love deserves your praise, no one can hinder thee. Ride on, King Jesus, no one can hinder thee. Ride
exalted, O Lord our God, Hosanna. Wow, isn't that beautiful? May our Lord be exalted. What came to mind, I've been reading on the Old Testament, the temple worship procedures, I guess. And when they come in waving the palm branches, my mind went to the wave offering. I'm going to read this morning out of Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verses 2 and 3. And then I also want to read out of a little passage out of Peter. And you shall remember that the Lord your God led you all the way these 40 years in the wilderness to humble you and to test you, to know what was in your heart, whether you would keep his commandments or not. So he humbled you, allowed you to hunger, and fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor did your fathers know, that he might make you know that man shall not live by bread alone, but man lives by every word that proceeds from the mouth of the Lord. And then jump over to 1 Peter 2, verse 2. I'll start in verse 1. Therefore, laying aside all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and all evil speaking, as newborn babes, desire the pure milk of the word, that you may grow thereby. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for this morning. Father, thank you for the palm branches and the children waving as they're walking in, Father. Thank you for the picture we get, or the picture that I got, of the wave offering toward you that was practiced in the temple. Father, I pray that this morning your word will penetrate each one's heart. Prepare the speaker, Father, this morning that he may bring your word and place your word on the tip of his tongue, Father. But prepare our hearts, Father, that we receive your word, that we desire your word, that we practice your word, and that we move forward in our next week, not only practicing your word, Father, but preaching your word. Pray that this in the holy name of Christ. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome here. It's good to see you all. Why don't you stand and join us as we sing praise?
Thank you.
find our life and love in Jesus' name.
shout unending praise, forever hallelujah, forever hallelujah. Your glory fills this place. We shout unending praise, forever hallelujah, forever hallelujah. Your glory fills this place. We shout unending praise, forever hallelujah, forever hallelujah. Your glory fills this place. We shout unending praise, forever hallelujah, forever hallelujah. Oh, great and mighty King, your reign and majesty, before your throne we sing, holy, holy. Oh, great and mighty King, for all eternity, we bow with heaven and sing, holy, holy, Lord.
Lord Jesus, you are the great and holy King. And we just praise you for the privilege we have to come together as your people, to remember the things that you have done, to worship you as King and Lord of our lives, of this church. We ask, Lord, that you be honored here today. In Jesus' name, amen. So when I think of Jesus' triumphal entry, my mind went back to Zechariah 9, verse 9. And it says, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and having salvation, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." This was penned maybe roughly 500 years before this fulfillment. So what confidence that gives us, you know. This was already prophesied, already talked about. And you just imagine the spiritual leaders of Israel, the teachers of the law, the Pharisees. They would have had this all memorized backwards and forwards and inside out. And seeing this come to fruition, it must have just rang in their ears and their hearts. Unfortunately, a lot of them were hardened toward it, but it still must have rang loud and clear. I just wanted to share those thoughts this morning as we go forward in this service. So just want to welcome any guests that are here with us this morning. Good morning to everyone here, and may you be blessed as you worship together with us. And right now I'm just going to look through some of the announcements here in the bulletin. Everybody would have gotten one of these inserts, the Standing Firm Conference. So read that through. All the information is there, everything you need to know about it. So it sounds like it could be an amazing time there. So keep that in your mind. Good Friday service this next Friday. It's going to start at 10 a.m., so feel free to come and join us as we reflect and remember what the Lord Jesus Christ has done for us. And we will also be doing communion. And just keep in mind membership classes and religious instruction forms. So there are some in the back foyer there. If you haven't filled one out yet, please do that. And then VBS announcement, Keepers of the Kingdom is going to be the theme, and that is set for July 7th to 11th this year. So you can read there for for some of the ways that you can help. Can be a committee member or a worship leader. There's multiple opportunities there. And then at the back, I see there's no youth events, so keep that in mind. So I just want to also announce, we want to pray for Wes and Josie Dirksen this morning. As Wes is now in the hospital, he's had a serious infection. So it sounds like he'll probably be there most of this coming week. So something to just add to your prayer list there. Pray for Wes as he's being treated, and also for Josie and her children, as you know, they probably are living with a bit of uncertainty right now, and they are without Wes. So let's take these matters to prayer right now. Our Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning. We thank you that we are privileged as your children to bring our requests before you, our concerns, our cares, the things that lie heavy on our hearts, Lord. This church body, Lord, we lift up to you these things. Just want to pray for George Weeb, our congregational care elder. Thank you, Lord, for the work that he does. We ask your blessing on him. Would you just continue to give him much wisdom? Would you equip him, Lord? Work in him and through him as he ministers and serves in this body. And then there are all the other people that serve under him, the small groups leaders and the sympathy, the cradle role, first-time parents, tokens of love, supper club coordinators, potluck coordinator, benevolence committee, men and women's ministries, all these different areas in our church, Lord, that serve this body. We thank you for each name, and even those maybe not mentioned here, the people that work behind the scenes to serve this congregation and to show the care and the love of Christ. Lord, we just ask your blessing on each one, and we ask you to continue to lead and guide, grant wisdom, and equip them to do your good work, Lord. We also want to lift up to you Edna Brown this morning and Gertie Brown. We thank you for these godly women, Lord, that are in this body, and we just ask your blessing on them. Would you just be with them day by day, Lord, as they wake up, as they go through their days? May they seek you first. May they be in your word. Lord, would you just carry them through each day and work in them and through them, Lord, that your glory may shine through. Lord, we also want to lift up to you the Graceway Church. We thank you for that body of believers and for the work that they are doing. And we just ask that you would continue to work in there. May they continue to learn from your word. May they continue to do good works in and among themselves and among this community, Lord. We also want to pray for Discovery Time at the South Oaks and Green Valley School. Lord, thank you for that that little mission that is going on there. So important. Lord, I pray that you would keep the doors open, that hearts would be open, that teachers would be willing to work with it, and that the gospel would go forward loud and clear, and that kids would come to know you, Lord. We just pray for the leaders, for the teachers, that you would equip them to share the gospel as they share the stories of the Bible, Lord. We also want to pray for Mwande and Charlene Manny, their children, Lord. Take care of that family. Would you strengthen that family unit? Give them grace each day, Lord, as they raise their children, as they serve in this ministry of Frontier Missions. Give them much wisdom. Help them as they make decisions, as they serve, as they work in this mission, Lord. And just work through them that the good news of the gospel would go forward wherever they find themselves, Lord. Also want to lift up to you our elected officials, Lord. Conrad Narth, Bob Legacy, Josh Gunther, And the Honorable Calvin Gertsen, Lord, thank you for each of these men, for the role they play in government, in serving their areas and their communities. We ask that you would bless them. May they seek you daily, Lord. May they seek your wisdom and your guidance. And may they be a blessing to their areas of service, Lord. And we want to lift up to you Wes and Josie. Pray especially for Wes, Lord, as he's in the hospital. We just ask your healing hand upon him. Give the doctors and nurses wisdom. I pray that Wes would rest in your comfort and in your care, Lord. May he be at peace. And I pray for Josie and the children. Strengthen them, Lord, as they are going through a bit of uncertainty in the week ahead. Father, thanks again that we can leave these things in your hands. And we have confidence in you, Lord. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're going to have the scripture reading coming. And after that, then just automatically, Children's Church will be dismissed. And then Dwayne Friesen's going to come up, and he's going to announce our missionary speaker and introduce him to us. So,
scripture reading is found in John 21, 1 to 14. John 21, 1 to 14. Afterward, Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Galilee. It happened this way. Simon Peter, Thomas, also known as Didymus, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two other disciples were together. "I'm going out to fish," Simon Peter told them, and they said, "We'll go with you." So they went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not realize that it was Jesus. He called out to them, "Friends, haven't you any fish?" "No," they answered. He said, "Throw your net on the right side of the boat and you will find some." When they did, they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." As soon as Simon Peter heard him say, "It is the Lord," he wrapped his outer garment around him, for he had taken it off, and jumped into the water. The other disciples followed in the boat, towing the net full of fish, for they were not far from the shore, about 100 yards. When they landed, they saw a fire of burning coals there with fish on it and some bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish you have just caught." So Simon Peter climbed back into the boat and dragged the net ashore. It was full of large fish, 153. But even with so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have some breakfast." None of the disciples dared ask him, "Who are you?" They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came, took the bread, and gave it to them, and they did the same with the fish. This was now the third time Jesus appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead.
So since I'm not quite finished creating my sermon, I need a little bit of help this morning, and it's not too late. So I have a question, and I need about 4 answers, and I think there's going to be a roving mic so that you can actually answer the question. So this is the question. What kind of question would you ask me to determine whether or not I love my wife and how much? So if four people could just stand up, be prepared to answer that, then the mic will come to you. What kind of question would you ask me to determine whether or not I love my wife?
Well, I'll be brave. My question would be, when you're planning things that involve her life, how much do you respect and involve her decisions in that area?
Got it. Next. We got one here. I see that hand. Is there another?
How often do you tell your wife that you love her?
Two more.
Are you preparing her to be blameless and holy before the Lord?
Am I prepared to be blameless?
No. Your wife. Preparing her.
Say that again, please.
Are you preparing your wife by teaching her the scriptures to be blameless and holy before the Lord?
Got it.
Do you fill and empty the dishwasher?
It's a good thing I don't have to answer these questions. I just ask the questions. We laugh, but there's some questions I can't use, but this one I can use. So I may modify it and say something like, do I do stuff for my wife? See, that'll still work for you, right? Yeah. I'll let Karen come up now and talk a little bit about what we do.
Good morning. We're Bob and Karen. It's been a while since we have been here, but we are very happy to be back. Just a little bit of background. We joined our organization in the year 2000 to do a short term overseas. And if you go to the next slide, you will see that then there were five of us. So this was a short term plan. We were going to do 1 year. They convinced us to do 2 years. We're like, okay, we can do that. Now, our short term is continuing. That's coming on 25 years. Our children are now all married, and we have five grandchildren. But going back, our first stop was Belize. And if you want to show the map, and Bob was teaching Bible at King's College. So we were there from 2001 to 2006. Bob absolutely loved teaching, and it was a wonderful experience. After our organization determined that it was now time for us to move on, they asked him to be the director of recruitment for Canada. So we did that for almost 10 years, connecting with people. just when we're starting to think, okay, maybe in a few years we'll retire, we got another request. Would we consider moving to Asia and do member care? Member care was something new for our organization, but my first response was, no way. I know what it's like to leave my kids when we were in Belize. Then they left us as they graduated. I said, I cannot do that again. It is too hard. I can't move to Asia. But God does have a way of working in our hearts, and slowly, after much prayer and talking to people, we accepted the challenge and moved to Asia. So we moved in early 2016. It was quite a culture shock, but I think we transitioned pretty well. So what is member care? That is a question that we are often asked. The original purpose was retention and encouragement for our overseas workers. A safe place where they could share concerns, a safe place for them to vent when they were frustrated, either about our org or anything else. It was also a time where we could show appreciation for what they're doing. So kind of it was a little bit like a pastor to missionaries. We pray for them, with them, we connect with them, rejoice with them when they're rejoicing, walk alongside them in their struggles. We help them in areas like marriage, which seems to be a big struggle. Team dynamics. All of the countries that we are in are limited access countries, so that means that they have to have a business or a job of some kind to be able to be in the country. Our goal is to visit each country each year. If you want to move to the next slide. So that meant a lot of travel. Our goal wasn't always met, but we do our very best. Between visits, we are able to connect using video calls or texting or email, whatever they prefer. We also found in the city that we were living that there were a lot of international workers, many of them living in the country that we lived in because it was safer for them to live there and traveled around like we did. So we started a 50-plus group. And the next slide will show a few of them getting together in our home. We found great encouragement, sharing with each other, encouraging each other in our work, hearing each other's stories, and praying for each other. Now, over here, we're kind of blending in, but on the next slide, you will find out that when we're in Asia, we're the ones that don't fit in. We're the pale-faced ones on the airplane. We're the ones that are dressed different, if you want to go one more slide. Bob didn't quite dress like they did, nor did I dress like the women. The next slide will show the women. I couldn't take a close-up one, but you'll see them sitting in the background. So we were the ones that stood out. Most Asian airports are crowded, so we had to get used to some of that, and loud. We traveled to many different, about 9 different countries in Asia, and when we do visit our workers, we like to take them out for food. It seems that sitting across the table with a cup of coffee or a meal is the best way to just have some really good conversation. And we tried to take them out so they can know that we really appreciate them. So our workers have to be creative in the way they can stay in the countries. The next slide will show how one of them made water wheels. He is very creative, an amazing evangelist, and travels around putting in water wheels and is able to share his faith that way. Today I want to talk more specifically about one couple in Asia. This country has many, many scooters. Traveling there was a bit nerve-wracking, and walking across the street was more nerve-wracking, but we learned that as a pedestrian, I have the same right as the person in the bus or the scooter or the car. So when I step off the sidewalk, as long as I don't stop and I keep going, they will go right in front of me or right behind me. I might only have 2 inches to spare, but they won't hit me. But if I stop, I am a target because then they don't know what I'm going to do. So you put your foot off the sidewalk, keep going. So the one I want to talk about, Kay, she's actually from Manitoba, not that far from Winnipeg, so you can kind of connect that way. A few years ago, she decided to do a short term, and this one is a shorter term. She was there for just over a year and loved the experience, and it gave her, you know, the inspiration that she needed. She came back to Winnipeg, finished her degree in university, and did her fundraising and moved back to Asia, was a wonderful support to her teammate. She was amazingly quick at picking up the language and just fit in really well. Now, she was in a small village, so occasionally they would go into the city to an international church that was in English, a little bit of a specialty when you're living overseas. It wasn't long, and she got to know the people in this church, and she met Elle. Now, even though Elle was from going to an international church, he was Asian. But they became friends, and one of the things she really liked about him, as they would hang out together, then he would greet somebody and say, "Oh, how did you know this person?" "Oh, I led him to the Lord maybe a few years ago." And then they'd meet another person. "How do you know this guy?" "Oh, he just became a believer last week." So she just found that he had an amazing gift of evangelism, and he was using it. So as the story would, of course, progress, they fell in love and got married. They now have 2 children, and I think she has decided to make Asia her home for life. They are just doing amazing. They continue to have a small fellowship in their village, and are just it is a struggle, but they are doing really well. So they still only have a scooter. So I'm going to share one need with you this morning. They really need a vehicle. One of the ways that they connect with people in their village is to try to help them. With their scooter, they take them to doctor's appointments or other places where somebody needs to go. When they were just 2 of them, it worked. When they had 1 child, it worked. It's a little tricky when you've got 2 kids. So they are really looking to get a small vehicle so that they can use that as outreach to those around them. So if anybody wants to help with vehicle fund, you can talk to Bob after the service. I just very recently got an email from her, and I'm going to read a little bit about what she wrote in her letter. She says, "One woman was recently very upset because they only gave her sandwiches, drink, and fruit after their fellowship time, but not any extra vouchers for food for the week. She became so upset that we wouldn't give her anything extra, because they didn't have anything more, that she cursed L and told him that he would be hit by a motorbike when he left his yard." Well, he's left his yard, and he's still fine. Then she writes, "We can thank God that we are not scared of the curses because of God's power." But these are the kind of situations that they are facing. So as you think of them, remember to pray for their witness, for their protection, and that God would continue to use them to reach the lives of those around them. Well, every report has to end with a sunset, right? I don't want to break that. So it seems that we are now also coming to the sunset of our ministry. We've been praying for about 2 years for somebody to take our place. Just recently, somebody has agreed to start, but not yet. So though we had been talking about retirement for this coming year, they've now asked us, will we go till July of 2025. And we've agreed to do that so that we can do a transition for this new couple that will be taking over the work in Asia.
Hope you brought your lunch. This is a bit of a culture where we're scared to, you know, give our age, but I'm just wondering how many people there are age 42 in here. Are you bold enough to stand up? I see a hand. Is there anybody else? 42. Another one, 42. Okay, what about within 2 years of 42? Does that work? Okay, there's another hand there. There's another hand there. Perfect. I was 42 years old when we left for Belize. So at 42, you're not too old to go overseas and do some kind of ministry God might call you to do. At that point, Karen and me had already been involved in youth lay ministry for 20 years. And now at the other side of 42, we've been 25 years with another organization. No, same organization. I'm sorry, same organization. So I'd be happy to talk to you about what that might look like. A couple of years ago, we built a new house in Morden because we were working in recruitment. We needed a place to live. Morden seemed to be the place. We couldn't find something. We built a new house. My brother comes over and sees this new house, and he knows we're missionaries, right? And he says, "Whoa, I should be a missionary," and looks around our new place, right? And I said, "Yeah, man, let me sign you up. Do it." Thanks for your participation in the questions. We will get to those later, to some of those later. But right now we want to look at John 21, and verses 1 through 14 has been read, and in a little while later we will read 15, 16, and 17. And as we dig into this profound message contained within this exchange between Jesus and Peter in John 21, 15 to 17, this passage holds a vital message about love and service. And it is a call for each of us to reflect on our commitment to love and serve God. Let me read this. John 21, starting at verse 15. Connie read 1 to 14 just a few moments ago. "And when they finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, 'Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?' 'Yes, Lord,' he says, 'you know that I love you.' Jesus said, 'Feed my lambs.' Again, Jesus said, 'Simon, son of John, do you love me?' He answered, 'Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Take care of my sheep.' The third time he said to him, 'Simon, son of John, do you love me?' Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, 'Do you love me?' He said, 'Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you.' Jesus said, 'Feed my sheep.' So as Peter is going about his work, finishing from time to time, he no doubt reflected on the time that he denied Jesus. I have no idea what Peter is thinking about in regards to his future, because after this episode in the court where he denied Jesus, he may well have been thinking about, well, maybe I'm not cut out for ministry after all. Yet he didn't cower. He didn't waste any time to get to the shore where Jesus was waiting for him. The confidence and the passion that had earlier fueled Peter's decisions, both wise and foolish, heroic and cowardly had been crushed out of him. So this impulsive zeal distracted Peter from acknowledging a lifelong problem. As long as there were external foes to fight, challenges to meet, difficulties to overcome, problems to solve, he didn't have to face that he was, in fact, quite powerless. Now let's see how that plays out. Jesus just met his disciples on the shore of the Sea of Galilee. They had fished all night. They had caught nothing. Jesus tells them to cast on the other side of the boat. And when they did that, they got all the fish they could handle. Jesus has breakfast ready for them. And after breakfast, Jesus confronts Peter in front of the rest of the disciples. And he asks them a very important question. Do you love me? And notice that Jesus asks Peter three times, do you love me? Why three times? I have no idea. When Peter was confronted with the opportunity to demonstrate his love for Jesus, he denied him three times. He denied knowing him three times. Now it's around a fire of coals that Peter denied Jesus three times. He lost his ministry, and now around another fire of coals, Jesus restores Peter to the ministry. Let's reflect back and think how Peter must have felt during these few weeks after denying Jesus. The night before Jesus was crucified, Peter told Jesus in Matthew 26, "Even if everyone else deserts you, I will never." So he has a friendship with Jesus. He has a relationship. He's seen miracles that Jesus has done, yet he's devastated. John 13 says, "On the same night, Peter said to Jesus, 'I am ready to die for you.'" It's clear that Peter loved Jesus. He had no intention of letting Jesus down. This is the same Peter that walked on water to get to where Jesus was. The same Peter who said in Mark 10, "Lo, we have left all and we have followed you." And it's the same Peter who cut off the ear of the servant of the high priest to defend Jesus. It is the same Peter who followed Jesus into the courtyard. Where were the other disciples? It's the same Peter who dove in the water to be the first to meet Jesus on the shore, which we just read. So Peter loved Jesus, but he'd also failed Jesus. And right now, I think the failing part is what's on Jesus, or rather on Peter's mind. What must Jesus think of me? Will he ever be able to forgive me? I really blew it. I'm a total failure. Peter had made some pretty bold statements about how much he loved Jesus. But when it came to crunch time, he bombed out. He let Jesus down. Now Jesus wants to restore Peter back to fellowship with him. And Jesus does have great plans for Peter. Jesus wants to restore him so he can become the leader in the new church. It appears that Jesus has more confidence in Peter than Peter has in himself. Nevertheless, Jesus doesn't condemn Peter for his lack of total commitment. Jesus sees Peter's heart, and he knows that Peter's ministry will grow along with his love for Jesus. So when Jesus asks Peter, "Do you love me?" It's interesting to note that Jesus starts at the highest plateau of love. I'm not a Greek scholar, nor will I pretend to be, but I understand that in Greek there are four words for love, three that are used in the Bible, and two that are used in this passage. First one is agape love, which is a love of obedience expressed in action, agape love, a love related to obedience expressed in action. And then there's the phileo love, which is a friendship love, like I'm fond of you. I'm not sure I want to be obedient to you, but I'm fond of you. And it's also interesting to note that when Jesus asked Peter, "Do you love me?" he says, "Do you agape me? Do you agape me?" And Peter says, "I phileo you." And again he asks, the second time he asks, "Do you agape me?" And he says, "I phileo you." The third time he asks, Jesus then asks, "Do you phileo me?" And Peter says, "Jesus, you know all things. You know I phileo you." It's like Jesus is saying, "I'm going to meet you where you're at, and I realize your love for me will grow. You denied me three times. You've told me three times that you love me. So when Peter is grieved, is it because Jesus asked him three times, or is it because Jesus had to come down to his level of confession? Jesus asked Peter if he really, really loves him, and yet all Peter says, "I'm really fond of you." So Peter's phileo fell short of what Jesus desired, but he does deserve high marks for honesty. Furthermore, it acknowledged that the truth of Peter's love, his affection for Jesus, could not be denied, but he realized he was powerless to avoid future failure, and he knew it. So at this point, Peter still not climb up to the level that Jesus wants him, but he's willing to admit without reservation that he has a deep love and admiration for Jesus. Now, with a proud self-confidence, a thing of the past, Peter is ready to depend on the Lord to accomplish ministry. And just as Jesus rescued Thomas from his hopelessness, or perhaps dogged pragmatism, the Lord now pulls Peter from his despondency. He invited this humble disciple to recast his nets for another miraculous catch, only this time for the souls of Peter, souls of people. Now let's go back to the question we asked right in the beginning. How can you determine, or what question would you ask to determine whether I love my wife? Let's just adjust that question a little bit to see if others can tell if we love God. And we're going to use some of the answers from the audience. First question I had is, how much have I done for her? If that's the way we can tell, whether you can tell whether I love my wife, how much have I done for her? My question then goes, let me reflect, let me bounce it back and say, how much have you done for God? When she makes you mad, do you have something nice for her anyway? When God makes you mad, what is your response? It's okay to be mad with God, angry, but what is your response? Is it appropriate? What kind of sacrifices do I make for Karen? What kind of sacrifices do you make for God? Am I preparing my wife to be blameless and holy for the Lord? I have no way how to use that here. But Francis Chan has a really good book to answer that question. Do I fill and empty the dishwasher? I do lots of things for Karen. Yes. Dishwasher's not my favorite, though. What do we do for God, even if it's not our favorite? Some of the things God calls us to, I hope it stresses you out, because it should. Otherwise, he's not asking you to do anything tough. How often do I tell my wife that I love her? How often do you tell God that you love him? It's often included in our songs that we love God, and I think that's great. But how often do we say, in the morning you wake up, before you reach for your phone, do you say, I love you, God? What about your Facebook? Is it obvious on your Facebook that you love God, or is it obvious that you love yourself? Have you been faithful? Is there an emotion that arises in you when you hear the name of Jesus? Or when you imagine and you look at him? Is there an emotion that arises in you? Is he someone you would die for? Are you really in love with God, or are you, or is your relationship really with God? It is important that at the end of your life, when it's just you and God, that you will hear, good and faithful servant, and not, depart from me, I never knew you. I knew your brother, I knew your wife, I knew your friend down the street, I knew the cashier at Walmart, but I never knew you. Imagine with me, you've gone on a 3-month missions trip from whichever church you attend. And you've met God there in a special way. And it's changed you positively. And you've seen change in your friends positively from this mission trip. And you come home to your church, and over the last 3 months, some cult has entered your church and destroyed your entire church the way you knew it. And a lot of the people are following the cult. Your parents, your family are following this new cult. What's your response to that? It is hypothetical, I understand that. Would you be able would you be able to look at your mom and dad in the eye and say, Mom, Dad, it kills me that you're not following Jesus anymore? Would you be able to do that? Or to your brother? Sister? Would you stay with Jesus in that situation? Honestly? Some of you love God when you have a whole bunch of believers with you. But what about when you're with your heathen friends? Who are you then? So Karen, my amazing wife of 45 years, asks me, is there something I do that bugs you? And I say, yeah, there's a few things. Then I ask her if there's anything I do that bugs her, and she says, let me get the list. It's interesting to note, though, when Karen recognizes that there's something that bugs me, she really does want to change. because she doesn't want to do anything that bugs me. So when you truly love someone, you want to know what bugs them about you. Psalm 139, search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there'd be any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. If you were to ask God right now, what am I doing that bothers you? What would he say? Really, we should take 10 minutes here and we should all write it down, right? We won't do that. But if you were to ask God right now, is there something that I do that bugs you? What would he say? David asked God the same thing. He says, help me get it out of my life. John 14, if you love agape me, you will obey what I command. Getting back to the agape where it's act of obedience. If you agape love me, you will obey what I command, and doing what I ask will become natural to you. You will do what I ask. You will do what I ask because the Holy Spirit will make you a slave to righteousness. Romans 6. And we'll get to that verse in a moment. There may be some of you in this room who are the most miserable people on earth because you're still holding on to sins, and holding on to sins makes worship difficult, probably impossible. Romans 6:16, don't you know that when you offer yourselves to obey someone, to obey him as slaves, you are slaves to the one whom you obey, whether you are slaves to sin, which leads to death, or to obedience, which leads to righteousness. So either way, you're a slave. So it works like this. When you sin, you feel guilty because the Holy Spirit is with you. When you come to church, you feel guilty because your sin is with you. Let me repeat that. So when you sin, you feel guilty because the Holy Spirit is with you. And I think it's good the Holy Spirit's with you. And yet, when you come to church, you feel guilty because your sin is with you. That is because you are a slave to righteousness. Let me illustrate. Now, I have to do this so you can all see me. So I have two drinks here, chocolate milk. It's a real thing. And anybody like lemonade? And beige Zia. Two drinks. I love Jesus. I love sin. I love you, Jesus. I smoke pot. I spend time in your word today, Jesus. I do porn. I'm a youth leader, Jesus. I sleep with my girlfriend. I teach Sunday school. I abuse my wife. You're miserable. You can't have both. You cannot have Jesus and love your sins. This is what happens. You want both? I give you both. You want both? Try it. It's great. It's gross. It's absolutely gross.
But we keep doing this. We keep doing this. We don't like it. We're not sure what to do about it. And we go back to the gross because we want both. I'll soon be sick. We have to remember we are slaves to righteousness. We're miserable because we can't have both. If Jesus came today, would he recognize you by your love for him? By your love for him in your obedience? Revelation chapter 3, the church of Sardis. You have the reputation of being alive, but you are dead. You have the reputation of being alive, but you're dead. So if you stood before God right now, are you real? You could be fooling everyone. What would your friends say about your relationship about God? What would God say about your relationship? Would it be the same answer? I hope so. Probably not for all of you. So are you about your reputation or are you about God, the Sardis Church? Are you dead? Really? Are you embarrassed with your relationship with God? Uncomfortable? What will happen in the end? Depart from me and you go to hell? And you'll think, huh, I fooled everyone. Everybody thought I was a Christian. Is that what you want? I don't think so. No, I don't think so. So long do we want to keep our facade going? God will forgive you of anything, but you got to get real before him. God, what am I doing that bugs you? Seriously, think about it. What are you doing that bugs God? Don't make a vow. Don't bother. Do you really love Jesus? He wants us to love him fully, wholeheartedly, which compels us to serve him wholeheartedly. This love cannot and should not be just an emotion, but a commitment to obey his commands and live for his glory. Again, the obey always keeps coming back, and it is the obedience which is expressed in action, which is the agape love that God desires from you. This passage challenges us to reevaluate our love for Jesus and our commitment to serve him. So let's strive to love him with a sacrificial love that permeates every aspect of our lives. As we do, may our service to him be marked with obedience and devotion, which brings honor and glory to his name. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there be any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. Amen.
Thank you, Bob and Karen, for being here this morning, and thank you for that challenge. I think we have things to think about this week, so thank you so much for sharing from the Word. And invite you to stand and join us in our last song.
Father, we We want to thank you for the challenge that has been placed before us, Lord. Help us as we go from here to obey your commands. Help us to love you with all our heart, soul, mind, actions. Only you can do that in us and through us by the person and working of your Holy Spirit, Lord. Help us to give ourselves to him, Lord, to allow him to fulfill that work. Be with us as we go from here, and may your light shine forth in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All his pardoning grace, no one can enter.